Hello everyone, today I am going to disassemble this particular blender. The idea over here is to figure out as to what are all the different things that normally go into a machine that we use on a day-to-day basis. Now for whatever I am going to do, I am going to use this particular screwdriver set from Taparia, a very good quality company for hardware tools. And this screwdriver set comes with different heads, okay? And I'm going to use the one with this particular star pattern. And well, you have a small collet over here. You can insert any one of the heads and then you can tighten this collet in order to use the screwdriver. Now I also have with me a RMS meter, which I am going to use to demonstrate certain qualities of the power which I will be using. So let us get started. Now before I disassemble things, I just want to show you a small tidbit. So if I am going to plug in these leads into the power socket, so let me do that. First I am going to put this thing on in a manner that you can see the reading, okay? Then I'm going to insert these leads into the socket, okay? So here I have an extension cord and then I'm going to insert them in. So you can see the voltage now, that the voltage reads as 243.5 volts. This is the RMS value of the AC voltage. Now let me look at the frequency associated with this particular AC supply. You can see that the frequency is 49.92 hertz. So right now we are dealing with a single phase supply with voltage RMS value of the sinusoidal signal being about 240 volts and the signal being at 50 hertz. Now, okay, so I'm going to go ahead and start opening the blender. Now before I open this, I just want to show you that this is in a working condition. My wife would be very unhappy if I take it to a non-working condition. So this comes with a bunch of detachable blades. So let me take off the supply before I show you this. So it comes with blades like this, okay? So in order to use this, so I have to put it into these cuts, push it in order to lock it in place, okay? Those flange like things on the rods help it transfer the torque onto this. Now over here you can see two intertwined blades. Now if I plug this in and if I start to play this, so this comes in 7 speed settings. So this is at a lower value, this is at an intermediary value of the speed, and this is at the highest speed value. So you can use this, put it in a dough and you can mix it up. So this is for blending liquids. So well, so this is working currently. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to open this up. So this is going to take some time, so please bear with me. There were just 3 screws which I had to open. For one of them I had to soften the plastic, expand the hole so that the screwdriver could go in. But once I opened them, I could see what is on the inside. This is how the inside of the blender looks like. So the power comes in through this wire. You can see the red colored wire and there is a hidden blue colored wire which bring in the AC power. The power goes to the transformer, the yellow colored thing which is lying below the motor, and the transformer reduces the voltage, and then there is a rectifier circuit which converts the power into DC power. The DC power through the carbon brushes, the black colored projecting part, the power then goes into the commutator, which then rotates the DC motor. The motor shaft
is connected to a worm. You can see a screw with threading that is called a worm, and the worm in turn rotates the two nylon worm wheels. There is also a fan which is attached to this screw, which is used to cool to cause air circulation and cool the motor as the motor runs. Please note the green colored lines I have drawn on the worm wheels and the mark I have made on the fan. As I rotate the fan, the worm rotates, and you can see the worm wheels rotate in opposite directions. In order to understand the relation between rotation of the worm and the worm wheels, I'll bring them to the aligned configuration and now rotate the worm and count how many times it takes to rotate the worm by one. So let's start. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. So as you can see, it took 20 rotations of the worm to achieve one rotation of the worm wheel. So what this does is, as the motor rotates 20 times, it leads to rotation of the blender discs by once. And also, whatever is the torque generated by the motor, the torque for the blender would be 10 times of that. So 10 plus 10 for the two blender discs would be equal to 20 times that of the torque generated by the motor. The white colored debris that you see over here is the nylon dust. So the worm screw that you see is made from steel, whereas the worm wheels are made from nylon. As the steel screw slides against the nylon worm wheels, it leads to generation of this fine dust over a period of time. Here, the motor assembly, the worm wheels are all attached onto the plastic body using these screws. So the plastic body needs to be strong enough to support all these loads. The speed over here is controlled using this particular mechanism. So as the switch is rotated, appropriate signal goes to the rectifier circuit, which is in turn controlling the motor speed. This is a zoomed view of the DC motor in operation. I would like you to observe the sparking which is taking place between the carbon brush and the commutator. The blinking lights thing, that's basically the sparking. It leads to erosion of the carbon brush over a period of time, and it will have to be replaced during maintenance. It may be noted that the ambient temperature is about 21 degrees Celsius, but when I focus the infrared thermometer on the running motor, the temperature of the motor reads as 36 degrees Celsius, about 15 degrees more than the ambient temperature. Whenever you have a rotating shaft, like in this particular case, it needs to be supported at least with two bearings. Over here, you can see the red colored bearing cap over here. So we have one bearing at this location and another at this particular location. So now that I had taken a close look at the inside of the blender, I had then went ahead and tried to put things back together. This was a real challenge. I did not really know whether I'd be able to do it or not, but after a little bit of iterations, I was able to finally put everything back together.
This is the blender after I have put it back together after opening it. Now let us see whether this is working or not. So it is indeed working, and even the speed thing is working fine. So I have been able to put it back together without destroying the blender.